So let me start with a timeline of what happened. So in 2011, late summer, in North Rhine-Westphalia in Germany, some dairy cows showed a transient fever. They had diarrhea, reduced milk yield, and were put off their food. And similarly, in the Netherlands, cows displayed similar symptoms. So tests were done for all the usual cattle viruses and proved negative. Then in the 18th of November, so that's just about 4 months ago, Martin Beer's group at the Friedrich Loeffler Institute announced the identification of a new orthobunya virus by next generation sequencing and metagenomic analysis on infected animals. And they called this Schmallenberg virus after the name of the town where the first isolate was made. They also isolated the virus and developed an RT-PCR test. Then in November, using the newly developed RT-PCR test, the Netherlands confirmed the presence of this virus in cattle. And then in December 2011, we saw a different pattern of disease, and a high number of lambs were born with congenital defects in the Netherlands, and analysis of the brain tissue of these lambs revealed the presence of Schmallenberg virus. Late December, ruminants born with congenital defects tested positive for Schmallenberg virus in Belgium, and retrospective testing of dairy cows showing fever of that year also proved positive. In January of this year, Schmallenberg was detected in deformed lambs born in France. And then on the 22nd of January, the first cases of Schmallenberg were reported in the UK, again in deformed lambs. In February, the virus was now detected in a goat in northern Italy and a sheep in Luxembourg. In March, Schmallenberg was detected in sheep in Spain. And then just last Friday, a positive sheep was reported in Jersey. So this is Schmallenberg. It's a nice little town in Germany. Its major occupations are textiles, forestry, and tourism. It's a very popular place to go hiking, and the residents of Schmallenberg are rather unhappy that they've been associated with this new virus. So, what do we know about the disease so far? So, the affected species are ruminants, cattle, sheep, goats, and one bison. Adult animals are largely asymptomatic, apart from these transient illnesses in cattle, but certainly sheep, goats, adult sheep and goats don't show any signs of disease. But the virus is able to cross the placenta in pregnant animals. And this leads to fetal abnormalities, joint defects, arthrogryposis, or hydroencephaly, which is when the brain fails to develop properly, and there are large fluid-filled sacs in where the parts of the brain should be. Some of the animals have jaw deformities, so that when they're born, they're unable to suckle. Those that are born with fused limbs risk damage to the mother when they can't be delivered properly. So it's a really horrific disease for the farmers involved. Healthy newborns are not viremic, though. And you can get instances where a pregnant ewe will have twins or triplets, and only one of the lambs will be affected. So this is from the Farmer's Guardian telling people how to spot Schmallenberg disease, and you can see that these lambs look quite horrific. Twisted limbs, twisted necks. When they're born, they last only a few minutes. And then the Sun dubbed this virus of the lambs. So the virus that was isolated by the German researchers, they were able to inoculate calves with the virus. And this showed that the virus gave a transient viremia, lasting about less than a week, and then was no longer detected. So this is the current situation in Europe. Well, it's probably not quite current because things are moving very rapidly. But you can see here, each individual pink dot there represents one herd of the shown disease in either mainly sheep, but also cattle herds. And then this is the situation in the UK. I made this slide from the data from the VLA website on Friday. On Wednesday, the total number of affected herds in the UK was 192. On Friday, it was 209. Today, it's 223. So this virus is present mainly in sheep herds in the UK, but also some cattle. In the UK, Schmallenberg is not a notifiable disease, so this is probably an underreporting of the cases of the disease. The economic impact so far, there is a significant economic impact for the European Union in that Russia has banned all live imports of animals, including pigs, and there's no evidence that pigs are infected with Schmallenberg virus, from the entire European Union, not just those countries that have shown positive animals, from the entire EU. And they've also placed a ban on what they call genetic material, i.e. semen for artificial insemination. Russia is the major trading partner for the EU for live animals, and I think the cost of the EU is worth about 118 billion euros a year. So obviously the European Parliament is very upset about this current situation. More recently, Egypt has banned the import of live cattle from the EU, and Uruguay has put a ban on all imports of semen for artificial insemination. In addition, 15 other countries, including the USA and Canada, have contacted the European Commission and have expressed concern about the situation. And so there may well be further bans on the export of animals from the EU to other countries. In terms of risks to humans, risk assessments have been conducted by the Dutch National Institute for Public Health and Environment, and then subsequently by the European CDC and the UK Human Animal Infections and Risk Surveillance. And all have concluded that it's unlikely that this virus can cause disease in humans, but it cannot be completely excluded at this stage. And I think this is a reasonable statement to make. As I'll come on to later, the closest relatives known to Schmallenberg virus are restricted to animals, and there have been no incidences of human infections. However, there are slightly more distantly related viruses that do cause human disease. On the NHS website, they've expressed it like this rather inaccurately. So they talk about German researchers have looked at the virus in DNA, it's an RNA virus, and found it lacking genetic sequences that would make it a threat to humans. I would like to know what those sequences are that claim. So I think they need to reword their website. Okay. So we have some questions. Where did Schmallenberg virus come from? How did it get to Europe? How long has it been here? How did it spread to the UK, taking a parochial standpoint? And will it become endemic? Okay, some fictions. It is not caused by circulating Fukushima radiation, as suggested on this YouTube video. Okay, it is caused by Schmallenberg virus. Secondly, it's not caused by genetically modified foods, it's not caused by people trying to genetically modify animals, and it's not caused by deliberately engineered viruses. So this website, if you quote from this website, this person wants you to put the citation up there. So there it is, above topsecret.com. I'm happy to do that. So those are some fictions. So where did the virus come from? Okay, so it's an orthobunia virus. So this is a family of viruses which have the following characteristics. They're envelope viruses, they're about 100 nanometers in diameter, and their genome comprises three segments of single-stranded RNA. These segments encode their proteins using essentially a negative sense coding strategy, or some viruses use a variation called ambisense. They're very simple viruses, they just have four structural proteins. They replicate in the cytoplasm-infected cells, and they assemble and mature intracellularly at Golgi membranes. And this is an EM picture of actual Schmallenberg virus obtained in the Friedrich Loeffler Institute from the isolate in cell culture. And you can see it's a circular virus in it, 100 nanometers. So schematically, it looks like this. On the surface of the virus, there are two glycoproteins called GN and GC. And these are embedded in a lipid membrane that's derived from the Golgi. And inside this lipid membrane are the three RNA segments, which are called S, M, and L, small, medium, large. And these RNA segments are encapsulated by the nucleocapsid protein in the form of a ribonucleoprotein complex. And associated with this ribonucleoprotein complex are a few copies of a large protein, which is the virus RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So all members of the bunyavirus family have the same basic structure, although there are differences in the sizes of the structural proteins and the sizes of the virion RNA segments. In addition, some viruses also encode non-structural proteins on the S segment called NSS, on the M segment called NSM. So, as some of you heard from Michel Bouard's talk yesterday, the bunyavirus family is very large. Well over 350 named viruses fit the criteria for classification into that family. The family is divided into five genera: orthobunyavirus, hantavirus, nirovirus, flebovirus, and tospovirus. And viruses in three genera cause disease in animals. So in the flebovirus genus, we have Rift Valley fever. Nirovirus genus has Nairobi sheep disease. And in the orthobunyavirus genus, we have Akabani virus, Cache Valley fever virus, and now Schmallenberg virus. So the orthobunyavirus genus, this is the largest genus of the family, well over 170 named viruses, which are conveniently subdivided into 18 serogroups. And Schmallenberg virus falls into the Simbu serogroup, which currently contains 25 viruses. It includes a number of viruses that cause disease in animals, Aino, Akabani, Safiperi, and Shimunda, for instance. These viruses are found across from Africa, Asia, into Australia. And these viruses are all transmitted by mosquitoes or midges, and some are preferentially transmitted by midges, others preferentially by mosquitoes. This serogroup also includes Oropushi virus, which is found in South America, and this is a human virus, and it's the second most important arbovirus disease in South America after dengue, and it's caused epidemics of tens of thousands of humans. Again, this is mainly a midge-transmitted disease in humans. So the Martin Beer's group has determined the sequence of Schmallenberg virus genome, and the S segment showed 97% nucleotide identity to a Japanese isolate of Shimunda virus. The M segment was 71% nucleotide identity to Aino, and the L segment 69% identity to Akabani, again isolates from Japan. However, we don't have in the databases sequence data for the M or L segments of many of the Simbu serogroup viruses, and certainly we don't have them for Shimunda virus. So we don't know what the pedigree of Schmallenberg virus is. One of the things about bunyaviruses, especially the orthobunyaviruses with a segmented genome, they have a high propensity for genome segment reassortment. And the more we sequence known viruses in this genus, we find more and more instances of reassortment that's apparently occurred in nature. So the true identity or the pedigree of Schmallenberg virus will require much more sequence data from labs around the world. If we look at the phylogeny, the S segment, you can see Schmallenberg at the top there, very close to Shamunda. That's nearly all of the S segments of the Simbu serogroup viruses. And the ones I've outlined in yellow are what are currently regarded as different species. I think this is a very transient classification. I'm actually quite unhappy with the species definition within the orthobuene virus genus, and we need to do a lot more work to really sort out. And for instance, if you look in the middle, Oropouche and Jatobel virus, Jatobel is actually a reassortment virus, although it has its M segment is the same as Oropouche. So it's related to these viruses that are found in Japan and Africa. So how did it get to Europe and how long has it been here? Well, I imagine that it got to Europe in an infected animal at some stage. As I said, a lot of work has been done in Japan and Australia on Akabani particularly. So we know that their animals only have a transient viremia. But they are amplifying hosts, and that if the animal is viremic and it's fed upon by a midge or a mosquito, the disease can be passage. So I would imagine that an animal was, because they don't show any symptoms, would have been imported at some time into Europe. How long has it been here? I don't think it was an animal that arrived in 2011. I think it's been here before. And I guess that if you just see the isolated incident of a malformed lamb being born, it would just not be noted. So perhaps the virus did arrive in Europe before last year and then took off in 2011. How did it spread to the UK? Okay, so it's a midge-transmitted virus. And this is data from the DEFRA website in conjunction with the Met Office showing the possibilities of windborne spread of midges from Europe during late summer 2011. And you can see that the counties that are showing positive Schmallenberg herds now are all liable to have received midges blown across the channel from Europe. Extends right down to Devon and Cornwall, and we'll also just touch on to the Channel Islands as well. So I think just like blue tongue virus appeared in the UK, blown across the channel in infected midges, this is what has happened in Schmallenberg. And just last week, I think, report of the detection of Schmallenberg virus in midges appeared. So the Belgian Federal Agency for Safety of the Food Chain has funded a surveillance program of Culicoides midges in Belgium since 2007. And so, again, a retrospective analysis of pools of midges collected in September and October 2011 was performed. Yesterday, you heard from Steve Higgs about the delicacy of dissecting mosquitoes. Here, the heads of midges were dissected off, and using the RT-PCR test, Schmallenberg virus was detected in two pools of heads of mosquitoes, Culicoides obsoletus and Culicoides delwolfi. And I believe today there's a third species of Culicoides that's also been shown positive. In addition, there was a press report that Danish researchers had detected Schmallenberg virus in midges collected in Denmark, although so far Denmark has not reported any incidents of disease in animals. Culicoides obsoletus and delwolfi are both species found in the UK. In fact, obsoletus is one of the commonest midge found in England. And so I think what will have happened is that the infected midges would have been blown across the channel, fed upon sheep herds here, and then perhaps where the virus has been picked up by our local midge species and transmitted further. Will it become endemic? Well, that's the big question, and I guess we're going to find out later in the year. It's lambing in the UK slightly later than in Europe, and certainly it's later in Scotland. So whether we get cases in Scotland yet, I don't know. I think what will be important will be to try and do Culicoides surveys in the UK to see whether it's got into the population here. These viruses, in general, are able to persistently infect the entire arthropod vector, including the ovaries, and the female midge or mosquito will lay ovaries that are already infected with the virus, and this is a very powerful way that the virus can overwinter in nature. So the midge season will start at the end of April, May in the UK, so I think if people can go out and start catching midges and look for the virus, we'll then get a better idea about the likelihood of Schmallenberg becoming endemic. A little bit about the virology then. So we got a sample of the virus from Martin Beer. The researchers in Germany had already shown that the virus can grow in Culicoides cells in culture and also BHK cells. It's a great virus to work with in the lab. It's got a very wide host range. So it grows in a range of mammalian cells. You see bovine, monkey, and human cells. This is typical of orthobunioviruses. They grow in a wide range of cells in culture. It plaques very well. You see big plaques in BHK cells after only 3 days. This is the genome of Schmallenberg virus. It's a typical orthobunioviruses genome. So the L segment encodes the polymerase. The M segment encodes a precursor to the two glycoproteins, GN and GC, and these sandwich a non-structural protein called NSM. And the S segment encodes two proteins, the nucleocapsid protein, and in an overlapping reading frame, but translated from the same messenger RNA, a non-structural protein called NSS. And NSS is a very important protein for the virus. It's the major virulence factor, and in mammalian cells, work done on other orthobunioviruses show that it's a major interferon antagonist, and it actually works in a sort of a blockbuster way by inhibiting all of cellular transcription, including all the innate immune genes. So in the lab, we have developed a reverse genetic system for bunioviruses, and what we do is to clone full-length cDNA copies of the three genome segments under control of a T7 RNA polymerase promoter, a T7 terminator sequence, and the hepatitis delta ribosome. And we transfect these, a mixture of three plasmids, into a cell that constitutively expresses T7 RNA polymerase. And the clones are constructed so that the RNA transcripts made in the cell will be of the positive polarity. So this is the antigenome sense, or the replicative intermediate RNA. And although these RNA transcripts are not 5' capped or 3' polyadenylated because they're made in the cytoplasm from the T7 polymerase, they do appear to act as weak messenger RNAs, and we get translation of all the viral proteins. And then these proteins in turn can interact with the positive strand antigenome transcripts and initiate the virus replication cycle, resulting in the production of infectious virus. So this then allows you to do mutagenesis on the cDNA clones to make viruses carrying defined mutations. So we established this system with Bunyanwera virus, which is the prototype of the family, and then subsequently Friedmann's Weber group in Germany established for Lacrosse virus, and four different groups, including my own in collaboration with Michel Blois's group, established the system for Rift Valley fever. Another group have also developed a reverse genetic system for Akabani virus, but using a different system than our own. However, we thought we'd have a go to see if we could establish reverse genetics for Schmallenberg virus, and we achieved this last week due to the sterling efforts in my lab of John Bakori, Elena Kudryakova, and Xiaohong Xu, who were able to clone out full-length CDNA transcripts check their correct sequence and produce recombinant virus. So we now add Schmallenberg to the list of bunyaviruses that can be recovered from cDNA clones. And this will be a great help in a number of aspects of the study of this virus, particularly practical aspects, as I'll come to in a minute, possibly about making vaccines. So in terms of if authorities decide to go ahead with making vaccines, what strategies could be used? So killed virus might be the simplest. For Akabani virus, there is a killed virus vaccine, formalin inactivated virus that works. Live attenuated viruses, again, there's a live attenuated Akabani virus made by traditional procedures of just multiply passing the virus through different hosts. And there's also live attenuated Rift Valley fever virus vaccines that you heard from Michel. Another alternative might to make would be to make virus-like particle vaccines. So if you just express clones of the virus nuclear protein and the two glycoproteins, you will get virus-like particles. And there is a lot of work on experimental vaccines based on virus-like particles for Rift Valley fever. So that might be an alternative way to go. But with the reverse genetics system, I think we have more opportunities. You can delete the NSS gene, so you would delete the virulence factor, and that will attenuate virus replication. You can delete internal sequences of the untranslated regions of the viral genome segments without touching the coding sequences, and that attenuates virus replication. And there's a talk by Beryl Mezo-Sanchez from my lab tomorrow in the RNA virus workshop about this with Bunyamwera virus. And you can also rearrange the coding and non-coding sequences of the virus genome segments, and we've shown that, again, this will attenuate virus replication. And the advantage of these procedures that I just outlined is that you'll be able to introduce essentially non-mutable, non-revertible mutations into the virus genome that might give rise to the potential for new types of attenuated live vaccines. So that's the situation we are with Schmallenberg. I haven't got a concluding slide because we're not concluded yet with Schmallenberg. The coming weeks, I think we're going to, I believe we'll see a lot more cases. A lot more cases in sheep in the UK as lambing really comes underway. In Europe, where lambing has sort of finished now, the number of new cases in sheep herds is going down. The number of cases in cattle herds with the birth of deformed calves is increasing because cows have a longer gestation period. And so I think this year we're going to see a lot more cases of Schmallenberg. And then the question is it going to stay? And if it does stay, what are we going to do about it? Thank you.